Good morning, everybody, and welcome back. So we now proceed with the introduction to programming, which is the first lecture on the theme of effective teaching learning of computer programming. In this lecture, I will briefly discuss the teaching and learning of computer programming as it happens, some of the points I had made during my talk on the introduction to workshops. I will elaborate these a bit further. More specifically, I will talk about the three contexts of data and information handling. I have not seen any book on computer programming discussing these issues, because some of these actually are outside the learning of programming, but they very deeply affect the way our students are able to learn. What are these three contexts? The first context is the human context, because that is the context with which our students are familiar. Before they have come to the world of computers in our engineering colleges, they have been interacting with human beings, and it is important to understand what they mean by exchange of information, by exchange of data values. How do they carry out these exchanges? The second context is the context of computing environment, comprising of the hardware, operating system, compilers, etc., where we expect people to interact with the computer primarily through a command language which is peculiar to operating system or to the development environment. And third and the last is the environment described by our computer program. In fact, that is the matter of study of detailed investigations during a course on programming. Once we understand all these three, we will then go to describe the program environment, which is the subject matter of computer programming. Here, I have chosen to model a computer program or a computer by one Mr. Dumbo, or what I call a Buddhu Ram computer. So we will describe the model for the Dumbo's memory. We will describe how Dumbo interacts with us, namely the equivalent of input-output operations. We will describe very briefly the way Dumbo does computing without really using the words like arithmetic and logic unit and processor and so on. We will try to go to the heart of how the computing is done inside, just by very simple example. Finally, we will talk about instructions and their execution, and most importantly, the ability of Dumbo to store our programs, leading to the stored program concept in digital computers. To begin with, let me consolidate our findings, and I believe most of my colleagues will agree with these findings, is about the teaching of computer programming that happens in our colleges. Typically, the following sequence is observed when we teach computer programming. First, we introduce the computers, a little information on hardware like the keyboard, monitor. Then we describe very briefly the operating system, again primarily the fundamental commands that we give to the operating system. We briefly describe the compiler, the notion of compiler, editors, etc. I would like you to appreciate that this entire introduction is covered in a very limited period at the beginning. Consequently, our students are not fully aware of the underlying concepts. Yet, because they are smart, they are able to learn to use these sort of mechanically. Then we proceed with description of the syntax of the chosen programming language, which we explain with examples. We introduce different features such as data types, control structures, arrays, functions, etc. And then the so-called advanced topics. Typically, in a course on C programming, these would include pointers, structures, files, etc. This subject often gets referred to by the language that is used. So this is an unfortunate consequence of our choosing a particular programming language. If we have chosen C programming language, students start calling this course as a course in C programming. If we choose Java, students call this a Java programming course. So it is not uncommon to find, in fact, students, even after they pass out their degree, to see that they write in their curriculum vitae skills, they will say C, C++, Java. I have not seen a single student writing competence in programming. In fact, we all know as teachers that if we at all, we wish to distinguish between different programming paradigms, the correct distinction is based on the type of programming that we do. Commonly acknowledged paradigms are procedural programming, as represented by languages like C, Pascal, Fortran, COBOL, or what have you. Object-oriented programming, represented typically by Java and C++, and functional programming, often used in solving artificial intelligence problems. While there are distinct features in these three paradigms, fundamentally the procedural programming has to be understood by all students. So even in universities where the first course in programming is taught using object-oriented languages, some fundamentals of control structures, assignments, variable types, data types, etc., have to be covered. Invariably, all over the world, the first course in programming often emphasizes procedural programming. And therefore, the language C is often chosen in these days. Earlier, it used to be Fortran or Pascal. In India, most of the universities has C as the first language chosen for teaching the first course in programming, and consequently, many people, including some of our teachers, refer to this as a C programming course. The first suggestion I would like to make to all my colleague teachers is stop calling programming courses by the names of the programming language that we use. We do a significant harm psychologically, because our students start believing that what they have learnt is a programming language. The objective of a first course in programming is to teach programming concepts. If we stop using such terms, students will also be discouraged. In any case, it is important to emphasize right in the first few lectures is what is being learned is programming concepts, and incidentally those programming concepts are being conveyed using a particular programming language, which happens to be C in our case. What about learning computer programming? So consider now that how students first struggle with actual computers, often failing to type correctly and speedily. And that is because in India, it is not a common practice for our students to learn plain typing when they are studying in schools. In other developed countries, you will find that most of the students studying in school are well versed with typing. Consequently, many of our students struggle with keyboard. They are unfamiliar with the ASDFG kind of sequencing that you see, and they take a lot of time in typing simple things. They will eventually become expert, as I said, they are all smart people, but this is an impediment. One way I have found not exactly a solution, but a reasonable stopgap arrangement is to give them a printed layout of the keyboard and ask them to practice just on that piece of paper. These days, fortunately, many students have computers at home and they are well versed with the typing, but this is a problem. Having overcome this, they then struggle to understand the programming concepts which are being doled out one by one. Now, this is where I would blame our syllabus pattern, which somehow is followed often very religiously. If the syllabus pattern says that you will first discuss the number representation, then you will discuss the data types, then you will discuss the assignment statement, then you will discuss the conditional, etc., etc., we often keep looking at these concepts, giving small examples, not necessarily full programs. So they struggle to understand the programming concepts which are being given piecemeal to them. Additionally, the problem which I mentioned earlier in the day, several first year students have studied in their own language and they find difficulty in understanding lectures given in English and also with English books. Last but not the least, while they may sketchily understand individual programming concepts, they are not very comfortable writing full programs. I would like to quote from a book which I have seen being a reference book in most engineering colleges. It is a book called How to Solve It by Computers by Drumi. He makes a statement there that we expect students to write programs without forcing them to read a large number of programs. He compares it with writing essays. You consider essay writing in English or Marathi or Telugu, whichever language. Our students, while learning to write essays, typically would have read 10 or 12 complete essays on specific topics. They understand how other people have written essays and then they start writing essays. In our case, however, without exposing students to read 10, 20 programs which solve specific problems, we suddenly start by asking them to write programs. This is rather unnatural. The fact that our students are still able to do that shows that the human mind is extremely capable. But perhaps we can help the students better if in all our examples we insist on writing full programs, even if we are explaining a very simple concept. This way we will be exposing students to read full programs, and also we will be able to slowly build the different features in such programs. Mainly, whenever we write a program, we are solving a problem. So, right from day one, we are emphasizing problem solution or solving the problem. In fact, the objective of a computer program is to solve a problem. It is not about the correct syntax used, it is not even about the correct semantics used, but how the semantics has been deployed to solve the problem is what is important. As a result of what happens in real life, you will notice, and I have found it at many places. By the way, my first hand experience with the teaching and learning of not just computer programming but our educational problems stretch back to 2002, when I took a sabbatical leave for 1 year and went around the country giving talks to engineering college students and teachers and interacting with them. I went to about 67 places. Amongst other things that I found, I noticed that on an average, the students who write the programs in programming course or even later, the size of their average program rarely exceeds 100 lines of code. I was making a comparison between our university style of education and IIT, NIT style of education. It is not uncommon for a group project in my class, for example, to turn out about 2000 to 5000 lines of working code at the end of the semester. Now, this is a very fundamental difference, because the size of code actually in its absolute sense is not material. But what is material is that the confidence that the students gain, they believe that they can write large programs which will work comfortably. Similarly, they struggle to learn problem solving due to the emphasis on details of syntax. I have tried to adopt a strategy in this course where, if you have seen the schedule in the Moodle, there is a topic that is discussed in the morning and there are examples in the second session in the morning. These examples are as well as introduction of a particular topic are all based on taking up a real problem, a fairly not a very trivial problem. Of course, we start the course with some simple problems, but take a really good problem and try to emphasize solving that problem. So, we will actually spend a lot of time in discussing, let us say, the underlying principle of Newton-Raphson method or the underlying principle of Fibonacci series when we look at that problem. And only finally, we arrive at the problem solution in terms of writing the program, during which time we emphasize the different aspects of the programming language syntax and semantics. Now, I would like to spend some time on the three different contexts which I mentioned that our students are familiar with. As a matter of fact, if we reflect back in our own lives, when we studied computer programming first time, we had roughly faced a similar situation. First of all, consider the human way of exchanging information or data. It has evolved from spoken languages to written scripts to organized information management using everything: spoken words, handwritten documents, letters, books. In fact, and I am talking about pre-computer era, even before the computers came, engineering discipline was well understood. So, there were instruction manuals, there were data sheets. In business side, we would be using registers, teachers use attendance registers, bankers use ledgers. There are application forms for various things, including when you want to book a seat or a berth in a railway. Nowadays, all of these systems are computerized. So, similar things have been mapped onto the computer screens, but traditionally these are the mechanisms that human beings use. Unfortunately, when human beings use these mechanisms, since they know they are dealing with other human beings, they take a lot of liberties. they may choose any one of these options at any point in time and feel fairly confident that the other humans will understand it. Unfortunately, that is not with the case with the computer programs. So, they find it quite confusing sometimes that how a human being is able to understand the information that I am giving, whereas this Dumbo computer is not able to understand. And it is important for us to bring out that distinction. In particular, human exchange of information, when it is done manually between person to person, can take multiple forms. So, to exemplify, I have taken some following sample exchanges between, let us say, a manager whom I call M and a clerk whom I call C as computer. Here is first scene. Let us say M has read the temperature in the room in which he or she is working from an instrument which gives readings in degrees Fahrenheit. The instrument was probably bought from United States, which specializes in showing Fahrenheit. Since we follow the centigrade temperature, our manager is not comfortable with the value that he or she has read. Assume the value is 86. And let us say M asks S to convert it in centigrade. Please note that when M asks S to convert the value in centigrade, M assumes that S knows the underlying formula. If the S does not know that formula, to explain that formula is equivalent to writing an algorithm and a program for S to execute. But we will keep that in abeyance because we are discussing only the data exchange. Consider this. How will M give this value 86 to S? M can do so in many ways. Number one, verbally tells him 86, and that is adequate. Number two, writes the value on a piece of paper. Now, this writing can be done in multitude of ways. One is just say 86 numerically. Second, he writes in words 86 so that there is no confusion. Third, he writes an elaborate thing, temperature is 86 degrees Fahrenheit. Even when you say writing a number 86, the font that the person uses, somebody would write in very large font 86. Somebody will write in such a small font that will be barely understandable. Somebody may write 86 in Marathi or Hindi or Telugu, where the symbol used for 8 and 6 are different than what you see here on the screen. Unfortunately, as far as human beings are concerned, since the context is same, we presume that M and S speak and use the same language, S will understand whether the font is small or big, whether the writing is in English or any other language which they mutually understand. And therefore, human beings have come to believe that exchanging information in any one of these forms is perfectly okay. Consider continuation of this scenario where S calculates the value, let us say converts value in the degree centigrade using the well known formula C is equal to F minus 32 multiplied by 5 by 9. Please understand that as far as human being is concerned, human being does not recognize the distinction between integer values and floating point values as we teachers do or as computers do. So, for a person, 5 by 9 is a proper fraction. The value is not 0. He is actually finding out a ratio with which he has to multiply F minus 32. And C will correctly find out this value to be 30. In this extant case, the value given is such that actually you get an integer number. But even if you were to get a fractional number, our S will be able to calculate it correct. How will S give back this value again? Going back the same mechanism, S will verbally tell manager value 30 or writes down on a piece of paper as 30 or word 30 or temperature is 30 degree centigrade or whatever. All of these are perfectly acceptable to M and understandable to M. Consider another scene. This is a more complex scene and I will later on in this workshop relate it to sorting and searching. Consider results of an exam have been published in a newspaper. And the newspaper gives the list of roll numbers of students who have passed the exam along with the mark score. The manager M is interested in knowing whether a particular student has passed the exam or not. So, M asks S to find out whether a student has passed the exam. Of course, M has to give the roll number of that student. Now, this roll number can be given in any one of the ways that we have seen earlier. But there is a question of giving S the list of roll numbers and their marks. there are two different ways in which M can give this list of declared results to S. One, M writes down all the numbers on a page in ascending order of marks and gives it to S. Second, the M hands over the newspaper to S, which happens to have the list in ascending order of roll numbers. While our students may not be able to appreciate the difference because both of them seem same to a student. For example, if I am a student, I will say, how does it matter in which order the roll numbers are given? After all, you have given me one roll number and I have to search whether that roll number exists or not. So, the naturally occurring algorithm to the student will be, start reading the roll numbers one by one. If you find a match, well, the student has been found and the marks will tell you whether he has passed or not. If you don't find the match, you say that student's result is not declared. But invariably, every student will come up with a solution which will involve comparing a given roll number with all the roll numbers in the list. Now, this is okay when there are 200 roll numbers or 300 roll numbers. Is this okay when there are, let us say, 100,000 roll numbers? Obviously, no. That is where we shall subsequently talk about the notion of sorted arrays, binary search, and so on. What I am trying to tell you here is that while human beings can interact with each other in multitude of different ways, when it comes to a computer program, there is a specific way of dealing with input and output, and that has to be clarified to the students right from day one, particularly when we talk about individual memory locations or collection of locations representing an array, sorted array, etcetera, etcetera. Next, let me briefly discuss the context of the computing environment itself. Please note, I am not talking about programming language or the environment that a program sees, that we shall describe in the end. First, we have discussed the environment with which student is familiar, namely during the exchange of information and data with other human beings. Next, I am now trying to describe the context of computing environment. Where do the students see the computing environment? When they first time sit in front of a computer. So, in our laboratories, we will have a first lab where we will expose the student saying, this is your terminal, this is your keyboard. Typically, a teaching assistant or a teacher will explain to him the basic hardware components. The student will learn these things mechanically. Monitor and keyboard, the student can see. Keyboard is something the student is going to operate upon. So, student understands these things better. The student can see some lines coming up, lines of text coming up on the screen. So, the student can understand these things better. But the concept of operating system, the command prompt, the notion of login, all these are new. The students might be thrilled. What the student is learning, and please note in his mind, his or her mind, what the student is thinking. The student tends to treat the computing environment as another hidden human being and therefore constantly compares in his or her own mind the interaction with other human beings that he or she is familiar with. So, I have been interacting with human beings in a particular way. Now, you are asking me to interact with this terminal and keyboard, and then you are telling me there is something called operating system behind it, and it shows a command prompt, and you have to give a command. Then I will suddenly tell you there are directories and subdirectories. So, there is a notion of a file system. The only directory I know beforehand before coming to your lecture was the telephone directory. I do not have any concept of a subdirectory. I do not know the concept of a file. The only file that I know of is an assignment file which I will submit, which contains some papers. I think we ought to appreciate that it is not straightforward and easy for students to make a mental model of this environment. Yet they are smart, as I said, and therefore they learn some basic things. But quite often, they form in their mind a semi-cooked model of this environment. We further complicate the matter by saying there are compilers and there are compile time options and you have to link the libraries and there are executable files and there are text files in programs. Then later on we say there are debuggers, there are development environments. In short, it is a recipe for a great disaster in confusion. The fact that our students are able to cope up with this, I will repeat once again, shows how smart human beings are. But we must endeavor to do something. What is it that we can do? Please note that ultimately our objective in the course is to teach computer programming. And the earlier we go to programming concept, the better it is for us to cover adequate material in that semester long course. But since this is the first course, This is the first time the students are coming close to a computing environment. It is well worthwhile to spend time in the labs in the first 2 weeks, where without necessarily explaining the conceptual framework of all these underlying themes, you just tell them what is the minimal thing that they require to understand. The notion of directories, subdirectories, text files which represent their program, the notion of compilation process and how to execute a program are the minimal thing. It is like you are teaching a student to drive a car without having to explain the underlying IC engine, the clutch system, the gear system, the steering wheel. As long as the student knows that if he turns the steering left, the car will move to the left. You turn the steering right, the car will move to right. If you press the accelerator pedal, car will move faster. If you press brake, it will stop. So, how do you extract the minimal important concepts and strengthen those while giving an overview of all the remaining things will decide how successfully or how easily the student can cope up with the entire thing. I will conclude this by saying that students have to cope up with all of this without properly understanding the underlying principles. So, too early in life, please do not try to unnecessarily emphasize clarity of understanding of the underlying principles of issues such as operating system, hardware, command prompt, file system, etc., etc. Whatever is minimal required for the student to quickly get into learning of programming should be our endeavor. Subsequently, during the course of this subject teaching, later on, we can elaborate some of these things. In this context, I find the way these syllabi are organized in many universities are to be blamed. The traditional way the computer programming was taught in the early evolutions, and I am talking about 60s and early 70s, when I and several of my senior colleagues learned programming. At that time, programming languages as we know them were just coming up. The essential computer was a digital computer. Those of you who have programmed the early computers will know that assembly language programming was still heart of programming. Compiler was an afterthought. And therefore, the normal teaching of computer programming always started with a complete hardware description, the description of machine language and assembly language programming, and higher level language programming was considered as a subsequent development. However, in modern days, it is well understood that to teach fundamental computer programming concepts as will be practiced by our lakhs of students in their professional lives do not require a thorough understanding of these underlying hardware and other necessities. They must understand the programming concept first. Those of them who have to, for example, work with embedded systems or with electronic systems or with other instruments, they may eventually learn all those details that we talk of. So, this is the context of computing environment. In a nutshell, we shall keep it short and sweet. Whatever is important will be indicated, and people will learn more by practice. Our obvious objective at this juncture is to ensure that our students are able to compile and execute a program when we start teaching program. So, first week, and I have tried to reflect it, the first lab session today that you will do, you will essentially familiarize yourself with the Linux environment and the Moodle, nothing else. So, you will adapt yourself to how to give commands, understand directories, subdirectories. Of course, I have shortened the thing because all of you are teachers and all of you know these concepts. Even if some of you have not worked with Unix, it does not matter because you are familiar with all underlying concepts. What I am trying to request you is when you go back, reflect upon how you would like to teach this portion to the students with minimal facts emphasized correctly such that they are sufficient for the students to ultimately compile and execute their programs. Any additional thing that we wish to emphasize, either because they are dictated by the syllabus or because we feel our students must learn, should be done appropriately at some later stage during the course. Finally, we come to the environment of a program. It is the model of a computing implemented by our program as seen by the user or as seen by the programmer. What is that model? The notion of variables, the notion of memory locations, the notion of data types, the notion of input output and subsequently the notion of files, the notion of control structures and data structures which we deploy in our program. This is essentially the subject matter of this computer programming course. Often we start with these concepts, and that is the order which we have to follow, whichever way we look at it. But I have found it useful to explain a fundamental model of a computer program, explain the notion of memory locations, input output, computations, etcetera, is to use what I call Mr. Dumbo. Let me explain that model to you. You feel you can use this or you can adopt your own model, but I believe it is important that in the first lecture we try to explain to our students in as simple a way as possible the fundamentals of this model of computing as is implemented by a program. Before going to the model of Dumbo, I will very briefly recapitulate the teaching of CS 101, which is our first course in IIT Bombay. In fact, to my teacher colleagues, I would like to request that if not individually, at least as groups, if they would like to comment upon how a programming course is taught, what are the various components in their own places, it would be perhaps a very useful thing, because all of us can learn from each other. There will always be some good practice followed somewhere which we would like to use. Coming back to CS 101, the course is titled Computer Programming and Utilization, thus emphasizing problem solving. By the way, in IIT Bombay and most rarely in all IITs, many NITs and many of the other reputed institutions, particularly those which have academic autonomy, a course is never known by the tool deployed. So, for example, we do not have a course in Oracle, or we do not have a course in MySQL or PostgreSQL. We have a course in database management system. We have a course in object-oriented programming. We have a course in web technology. We do not ever mention the specific technology by name. We currently use C, C++ to convey programming concepts. I would also like to suggest, I would also like to mention that this course is taken by all first year students in IIT Bombay. And primarily it is regarded as a service course and not as a first course to computer science students. For computer science students in their second semester, we have a special follow-up course. But this course is primarily meant for teaching basic programming concepts to students of all branches, because we know that mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, civil engineers, geologists, physicists, chemists, everybody is going to use programming to some extent or the other, and therefore this course is a course meant for all students, and therefore we emphasize problem solving. So we always discuss a problem first, we then describe a solution which is akin to evolving an algorithm, and then we develop the program to implement that algorithm. We often attempt to show complete programs. If there are segments to be discussed, they are discussed only in the context of the complete program. A segment is rarely introduced for the first time when talking about a new concept. First, a program will be shown and then a segment will be described or discussed if need be. Not everybody may agree with this style. I am just describing what we do at IIT Bombay. And I am not talking only about myself. We have had about 10 teachers teaching this course in the past 10 years. And as you know, there is a joke about teaching computer programming. The joke says that if there are M teachers teaching computer programming, then there are N different ways in which programming is taught, and N is often greater than M, because the same teacher may hold different ideas of teaching programming at different times. This is only the first part of the joke. The second part of the joke says that irrespective of how the programming is taught, a student learns programming on his or her own. That is slightly derogative, but there is a partial truth in both of these statements. What we are trying to come together in this great collaborative endeavor is to learn from each other the best practices and perhaps adopt some of them in whichever way we teach the course. So coming back to CS 101, our lab assignments often have ready programs which students have to suitably modify. So we typically give full programs in the lab assignments which the students are required to suitably modify. This works very well initially. Please understand that if I expect a student to write a program even of 100 lines, to expect a student to type in 100 lines in a limited time of the lab is unfair. On the other hand, what do we want to teach the student and what we want to test whether the student has understood or not are some very specific constructs within the program. So, there is no harm in giving a whole lot of mundane things pre-written and already kept in the appropriate directory. For example, include stdio.h or in C++ include IO stream. This is a stupid statement which if every student has to type again and again, it's completely wasteful. It does not add any value to either the understanding or the concept of the program. Anyway, as I said earlier, the students form a team to do a course project. By the way, what you call a subject in IIT, we call a course. So, consider this to be a subject project. Typically, the code written often exceeds 2000 lines and this all happens within a semester. The projects are assigned to the teams of students somewhere at the end of the first month of the course. And in the remaining 2 months, the students work on this project, which is a fairly larger problem, and they come up with a solution. The approach that we choose in this workshop is that we will keep in mind the syllabus usually followed in most colleges. I would like to inform all the participating teachers that as a preparation for this workshop, almost 2 months ago, we conducted a coordinator's workshop where our colleagues from the respective centers where you are attending this workshop came to IIT and participated. We had done similar thing in the pilot earlier. What we did is we collected typical syllabus and the examination pattern and some of the examination papers from various colleges and universities. As a matter of fact, later in the workshop, I will expect each one of you or the teams or the people who are coming from the same college to contribute to this general knowledge, namely what is the syllabus that is followed, what is the teaching style, what is the evaluation pattern, and what are the sample question papers. So, what we have done is, we have tried to generally cover topics in that order. Unfortunately, there is not a single order which is followed everywhere in the country, but fortunately, we found a lot of similarities. In fact, if you will see the schedule of this workshop, you will find roughly these topics appearing in that order in which they appear in your syllabi. However, the IIT style is chosen to always take a problem, work out its solution and then discuss the complete program. So, each problem and the corresponding program, we have tried to say that a new programming concept is implicitly introduced in the process. For those of you who want to adopt this style, you may still use this style, and additionally in a lecture, you may want to emphatically state certain details of syntax and semantics which are indicated as requirement in your syllabus or on which questions are asked specifically. Incidentally, I have seen many question papers in which we see question 1 part A explain something, part 2 write short notes on, part 3 describe something. Our style of teaching computer programming and evaluating the knowledge of computer programming is completely different. We never ever have such explanatory answers sought from the students in our papers. Our papers have problems which are all programming problems, and students are simply required to write the programs, either full programs or partial programs. We genuinely believe that that is how a programming knowledge should be evaluated. However, if the syllabi and the examination pattern of different universities required such explanatory answers to be given in the final exam, then obviously such things must be discussed and described by the teachers while they teach. I would submit that it is possible to combine the present approach that most of you take with the approach that some of us have practiced not only in IIT Bombay, but in many institutions across the country, as I said, wherever the academic autonomy is available. I would suggest that please try to find out the best of breed combination of these approaches to decide the way you would like to teach. In IIT, as I said, the labs will require modifying and executing given programs, and there will be group projects. With this now, I proceed to describe the model of computing as exhibited by a computer program. This is a different way of looking at it. So, I would submit you please look at this. You may want to adopt this or a similar strategy later. So, first of all, I have tried some caricatures. I call this a Buddhu Ram Computer or Mr. Dumbo. In my initial courses, I used to use this kind of line caricature, but ever since we embarked on this national mission, I got some animators to work with me. And a colleague of mine, Mrs. Sasrabuddhe, actually had worked out a model which looks like this. So it has a monitor-like thing in place of a head. There is no keyboard shown here, but our students will implicitly assume. So this is the Buddhu Ram computer. Mr. Dumbo is characterized by our statement that first of all, Dumbo cannot do anything on his own, but can execute given instructions correctly. Dumbo can do arithmetic. Dumbo can do logical comparisons, Dumbo can manipulate strings. Essentially, Dumbo can manipulate values and produce resultant values. Since he can compute, we call him a computer. This is by far a simplest definition of a computer as Mr. Dumbo. By the way, the word Dumbo I have seen does interest and impress the students because they can relate to Dumbo as somebody less than themselves in intellectual capability. It is very important for us to convey to our students that however comprehensive and strong the machine might look, as human being, you are always superior to that machine in both your thinking capability, and therefore it is your endeavor to make that machine work to your satisfaction. So our Dumbo computer is a dumb fellow. Dumbo has very poor memory. So we state that Dumbo cannot remember anything in his head. Now if the Dumbo has to compute something, Dumbo has to remember at least the values which we have asked him to compute with. So how does Dumbo solve this problem? We introduce a memory model for Dumbo. We say that while Dumbo has poor memory, Dumbo uses a cupboard with drawers as memory. So this is the Dumbo's memory here. These are drawers. I have artificially labeled these drawers as A, B, C, D, E, F. How does Dumbo use this memory? We say that each drawer contains some value. For example, a drawer may contain a number such as 437. A drawer may contain a string such as run a day. We will say each drawer is a memory location. It can contain a value. So location B contains 437. Location F contains the string run a day. I hope you will appreciate that when we are going to teach C programming in further details, we will have to tell students at some stage that the entire word run a day will not be stored in a single memory location. However, conceptually, in IIT Bombay at least, we teach C, C++, and therefore we have a type called string. In C, we do not have a type called string, but you will agree the programmers are able to write such strings in their program. There are occasions when such things are written and such things are handled by C. And there is no harm to convey to students that the various data types, look at what we are doing. We are achieving two or three things. We are able to introduce the notion of a memory location. We are able to introduce the notion that a location will contain one value. And we are able to introduce a notion that a value could be numerical or string. This is good enough to begin with. We further emphasize that each location can contain only one value and not multiple values. Now, how does a value get into a location? We describe the following scenario. Either Dumbo stores a given value there, or Dumbo calculates and stores that value, or some values may already exist in a location. How can such values exist in a location? Well, these values are not supplied by us, so we say such values are unknown or undefined. How does Dumbo store a given value? Obviously, there has to be some mechanism for us to give a value to Dumbo. Essentially, we emphasize that Dumbo can either take a value from us and store it inside, or Dumbo can calculate a value and store it inside. And we conclude that there is no third way for a value to get into a memory location. We indicate this by another model here. So this is exchanging values with Dumbo. I have put a caricature of a cart here, a wheeled cart or a wheelbarrow, which is shown to work on a path. Essentially, I am introducing the notion of a data bus. Please note that there is a mistaken mapping that will happen in the minds of students at this stage, which I think is perfectly right. The notion of a data bus in a computer is not that of a bus or a vehicle or a car, but it is a path. However, the students, when they see data bus, they will think this cart is a data bus. This is okay at this juncture. We are not going into the details of innards of the computer. So it is perfectly all right for students to imagine that somehow if I give a value 58 to Mr. Dumbo to be stored in one of the memory locations, Dumbo will take this value in a cart from us to the computer's memory and put it inside. Now, even exchanging values, we say Dumbo will not automatically do it. You see, in case of the exchange of humans between manager and the clerk, when manager gave me a paper, I automatically took it, read it, and sort of stored that value in my mind. Now, this I will not do directly. If I am a computer, if I am a Dumbo computer, I must be told to do this. So, we give an instruction, C in greater greater B. Why do we use greater greater? Why do we say C in? Why not we use any other phrase such as input, read, get, or even scanf percent D and B? I would like to spend a minute to describe this in details, because this has very important repercussions on how our students appreciate programming, particularly in the early months. This is the lacuna which happens whenever we use any programming language, and in particular whenever we use C programming language. Those of you who are familiar with other programming languages will see, for example, in Fortran I could say read star. In C++ I will say C in. In C I will have to say scanf double quote percent D double quote closed comma and B all enclosed in parentheses. You will all agree that for a student who does not understand the notion of a function, who does not understand the notion of a pointer, who does not understand the notion of string with percent, etc., to semantically understand the meaning of this at an early stage is impossible. The way we solve the problem in IIT Bombay is that for most of the initial part of the course, we use C in and C out as input and output instructions. I would humbly submit, particularly if you are using the GCC compiler, which we recommend strongly and which is what you will be using during the workshop, there is hardly any distinction between C and C++ as long as I stick to using only the input-output statements of C++. Please note that in C++, strictly speaking, the greater greater symbol represents an operator in the context of object-oriented program. But it is easy for us to tell the students that this is an input instruction. So whenever I say C in, Mr. Dumbo will take some value from us, and whenever I say C out, Mr. Dumbo will give a value to us. For those of you who would like to still introduce scanf and printf very early, what we will do is in our programs, towards the end of this workshop, if not at least at the beginning, we will redo all our slides and we will introduce as comments in our program the scanf and printf statement corresponding to every C in and C out. So this is for the benefit of those who would like to take these programs and use them. They could simply comment our C in, C out, uncomment the scanf and printf, and compile these programs using a C compiler rather than a GCC. Anyway, coming back to now this, Dumbo will collect a value given by us, will take it to his memory cupboard and store it in location B if we have set C in greater greater B. In the process, any earlier value will be overwritten. This might appear to be a very simple concept, but let me state that it is very important for us to emphasize to the students that when a value goes from outside the environment into the computer's memory location, the old value is overwritten, only the new value stays there. In exactly the same way, for exchanging values, we will say Dumbo can output values from locations to us, and the instruction to do so could be C out less less G, or C out less less A less less G less less quef less less root. Essentially, we can list a series of names of the drawers or the tags or the memory locations from which we wish to get the values out to us. And we explain this by saying Dumbo will copy values from memory locations and present these to us. What is the most important thing to state at this juncture? values in the locations themselves are not changed. So, we distinctly define the difference between an input and output operation. An input operation changes the value of a memory location, whatever was the old content is overwritten. An output operation does not at all affect the value stored in the memory location. We now introduce an additional feature by saying that incidentally in the output command or instruction to Mr. Dumbo, we can also include an explanatory string. For example, if the location C represents some kind of a count, then just saying C out less less C will just give us a value. We won't know what that value is. Whereas if we ask add an explanatory string, the meaning will be clearer to us. We would also like to emphasize to our students that when they go to a computing environment and when they are executing a program, on each line after they begin the execution of the program, these are the things that they will see: input to be given by us and output given by Dumbo. And therefore, the lines of text or lines of or the variable names etcetera that we write here have a direct implication on the way input and output is done. So, let us try out Dumbo's input output. We say here C out give values for B, C in greater greater B. We will explain to our students that when we say C out give value for B, Mr. Dumbo will actually show us the string give value for B. So, Dumbo is asking us give me some value and value for a name called B. Then it will execute the instruction input B and will take probably the value, let us say 437 that we give, and it will store it in location B. If we wish to give a character string, well, it could read it and put it in location F. Those of you who do not wish to introduce the notion of character string as early as this may simply discard this particular slide and the corresponding strings. Let us now try to build a model of computing that Mr. Dumbo follows. Consider this: if two numbers are stored in drawers A and B, let us say 35 and 12, Dumbo can add these and store the result in another drawer, let us say we call it sum. This actually is very straightforward and most students understand it. There is a value in drawer A, there is a value in drawer B, these two values are to be added and the resulting value is to put in the drawer or location called sum. Please note that ideally I should have shown the value inside A also. This is the drawing which I myself made, and I found out that if I opened the drawer A, the drawer B got hidden. So, I could not show both. Perhaps it is bad drawing on my part, but in some animation that I will show, I have tried to correct that situation. To explain that A contains a value 35 and B contains the value 12 and the sum is unknown but it has to be computed, I have tried to correct it by showing this. To explain how Dumbo is computing, first of all the instruction that we give Mr. Dumbo. The instruction in our case will be sum is equal to A plus B. While we do spend some time in describing the distinction between an equation and assignment at a later stage, my suggestion is at this juncture, if we just say sum is equal to A plus B, most of our students will understand what we are trying to tell Dumbo. They will understand that we want Dumbo to evaluate A plus B and somehow put the value in the location for sum, because that is what we have stated earlier. While showing Mr. Dumbo thinking very hard as to how to add this, I have done something else. I have put here 35 in brackets merely to indicate that the drawer A inside contains the value 35, whereas the drawer B is shown to contain the value 12. The drawer sum continues to contain a question mark. It is useful to indicate to our students once again, based on our earlier description of the model, that question mark does not mean an empty drawer. Question mark means some value which existed in that drawer because of some other earlier program that could have been executed. So, as far as we are concerned, that value is a question mark, is an unknown or undefined value. How will Dumbo carry out this calculation? Well, in my model, I say that Dumbo will use sheets or registers. First, Dumbo will access the location A, copy the value 35 into a register. Next, Dumbo will access the location B and copy the value 12 into another register. Then, on this register, on a working table or workbench, Dumbo will compute the sum total to get 47. And finally, Dumbo will store the result value back in location for sum. After Dumbo completes the execution of this instruction, the location sum, instead of a question mark or an undefined value, will now contain the value 47. I have tried to show this by this Dumbo computing caricature, which says Dumbo uses a set of local registers which are called working sheets on a table. So what I have shown is value 35 comes from A. I am sorry, I should introduce that 35 as a hidden thing, or some colleague teacher would like to redraw this drawing by pulling out a drawer A and shown 35 there. Then this 35 and 12 are shown on this table. The value 47 is shown to come out, hopefully in a third register, and the Dumbo is going to put this value 47 back into the sum. Consequently, we show that A and B continue to hold the existing values, the location sum will now contain 47. We now say that this Dumbo model represents our computer. To emphasize the same concepts and to strengthen the notion that there is a memory location which is akin to a drawer, that the Dumbo uses a card to do input-output operations, and Dumbo does computing using some kind of a register or a workbench, what we have attempted to do is to create two educational animations. These were created by expert animators. They are probably not the best, but I believe this is a good attempt. I would like to show you those two animations now. So here is our Dumbo. This is a caricature made by our animators. This is the cupboard with various drawers, artificially named as A, B, C. The animator is showing that every drawer can be opened and can be accessed. Here is Dumbo being shown to get an input value of 5 and putting it in one of the memory locations. So he is opening the drawer and putting that value inside. So the value goes into a memory location here. This is, and the Dumbo of course takes the card back. Let me put it this way, it is a very small animation, but I think it is very instructive. Let's quickly watch it. It is a few seconds animation. This is our Dumbo, so a human-like model. This is the memory drawers with various labels there. And an input-output operation is being shown to get a value from outside and put it in one of the memory locations. So this is a cart, and this value is being collected by Mr. Dumbo, and this value is being put inside the memory drawer. There are umpteen ways in which this model can be made better. Our animators and some of my colleagues are already working on it. But I thought there is another animation which I would like to show you. This describes the way Mr. Dumbo does computing. So here is the second animation where there is an input of 35 in variable A, input of 12 in the location B, and then Dumbo has to calculate sum of A and B. The location C is shown to have a question mark. So what Dumbo does is, notice he makes a copy of 35 and puts it on the workbench on a register. Then since he has to add from location B, he makes a copy of the contents of location B and copies that value in another register. So he has two registers in which he has 12 and 35. Now he is shown thinking. He adds 12 and 35 to get value 47. Now Dumbo picks up that value 47 and puts it inside the register. At the end, Dumbo shows that A continues to have 35, B continues to have 12, but C now contains 42. You will agree that this simple animation can go a long way in emphasizing to our students, first of all, the notion of a location. Second, the notion of a tag or a name for a location. Third, the fact that location can contain only one value. Fourth, the fact that whenever either an input operation is done or a compute and assignment operation is done, whatever is the old value in the location, it gets destroyed and replaced by another value. I have found that this kind of introduction is often adequate for students to form a simple model in their minds. So these were the two animations. Incidentally, my colleague Professor Sridhar Iyer started a very large project a few years ago on preparing an open source repository of educational animations. My project is taking cue from that, and we have now animators working to create educational animations not only for this course but for several other courses. Later on in this course, I will show you an animation developed on showing the working of disk drives. So, you will see how disk drives are to be used, are explained to the students on how reading and writing of blocks on the disk drives happen. I will show that animation later, but I will request all the colleague teachers to think of different ways or different ideas which could be shown better through an animation of this sort, and we will be very glad to receive those suggestions and work on those animations at a later date. Now, we come finally to describe as to how we give our instructions to Mr. Dumbo. In this context, we compare Dumbo with other machines. And we tell our students that as far as other machines are concerned, whether a lathe machines or a fan or a motor or a whatever machine that we can think of, they will take one instruction at a time and execute it. So, if I press a button, a microwave oven may start working. If I press another button, it will set maybe power to something else. Basically, I give one instruction, it is followed by the machine instantaneously. Dumbo is special because we can write all instructions in advance and give the entire lot to him. And such a set of instructions written in advance by us to be given for execution to Mr. Dumbo is called a program. This is essentially the concept of a computer program, and I have found this to be an extremely simple and elegant way to explain to students what a program is. Additionally, we said Dumbo is special. Not only he can read my program instruction by instruction and execute them, he is able to take my entire program, even if it has 100 instructions, 500 instructions, and store all those instructions in my program inside his own memory. And that is why we call Dumbo a stored program concept, or Dumbo has the capability of storing programs. One question students may ask, if Dumbo has cupboards which can store values, where does Dumbo store instructions or programs? Well, the correct answer is in the same memory. However, we don't want Dumbo to get confused between an instruction and the data values that those instructions are going to manipulate. So, we say that Dumbo uses some space of my cupboard to storing data values and some other space in the same cupboard to store instructions or program. I have found it extremely easy later on to relate the notion of instruction space and data space when we explain it later to our student. There is no harm in introducing these two terms here. Conceptually, we can tell them, imagine the cupboard is broken into two parts, or divided into two parts. One part, let us say, contains only data values which we want to be manipulated, and the other part will contain instructions of our program. That in any case is often the reality. Then we show a complete program to our students. So, here is a program one. Of course, what I am trying to attempt now, and we will try to do that before the workshop ends, that we will be providing all the sample program as separate files. So, I have named those files now. This will be called prog1.cpp. Our endeavor will be to create two versions of each file. One is prog1.cpp and the other is prog1.c. What is the distinction? As I told you earlier, we prefer to use C in and C out in all our programming courses. We ask students to compile these programs with C++. However, in most of the lectures, in major part of our course, we do emphasize constructs of C program. As I said, we consider it completely trivial and unnecessary to talk about whether we are using C or C++, as long as people learn the programming concepts. If you are comfortable with that, in your teaching you can adopt these slides without any change and use prog1.cpp, prog2.cpp, etc. If you are uncomfortable with that, you can use prog.c, prog1.c, prog2.c, etc., which also will provide. I will try to finish all that work at the end of this workshop. If not, within the 2 weeks that you submit your assignments, my staff here will submit this assignment, and we will definitely have all of these available to us. So, here for example, I have said include IO string. In a comment, I have said include stdio.h for C programs for using scanf and printf. Using namespace std, that is a requirement whenever I use IO string. Please note that whether I use C programming language or whether I use C++ programming language, for my students who are barely becoming familiar with the model of computing as used by Dumbo, all of this is Greek and Latin. What is slash slash? What is hash include IO stream? what is include this, what is int main opening bracket closing bracket. All of this is Greek and Latin, and I can assure you that most of the students cannot understand the underlying concept. In my humble opinion and in the opinion of many of my colleague teachers who have taught this course, we emphatically ignore these statements at the beginning. We just tell our students that look, the computing environment including the compiler and things like that are such that unless we put these lines of text, our environment will not understand what we are doing. However, as far as we are concerned, our program is from here up to here. Even the return zero, they will not understand. Why do we use the word return, and why zero being return is not a concept which can be very clearly stated. At least in the first lecture, maybe in the second and third lecture, it is better to keep mum about these, except to say that look, these statements have to be there. Eventually, we will explain what these statements mean. And students are comfortable with it, because at this juncture, what we are trying to suggest, we are trying to augment or we are trying to consolidate the computing model that they have formed in their mind looking at the Dumbo. So, here we are saying we have declared A and B, what is int A and int B. At this stage, without going into the details of integer, floating point, string, whatever, whatever, we will simply say this is the way in which the C programming language declares the labels for those drawers or memory location. So, once we say this, Dumbo will reserve a location for A and a drawer for B. And then rest of the instructions you will see are exactly what we had described. The only difference is in the example we had C equal to A plus B, here we are saying sum is equal to A plus B, and this is a working program. So, this program people can execute, they can give two numbers, they can see result working out correctly, etcetera. Here is another program to convert temperature from degrees centigrade to degrees Fahrenheit. I inverted the problem which I described while discussing the context of the human interaction. We call this program 2. Again, in this program there is include IO stream using namespace std, etcetera. It is useful to tell people that such comments are written because the programs are not only read by Dumbo, but they are also read by human being. So, you write a program, I will try to read it, if for nothing else, either to understand that program or to correct that program if there are mistakes. And if I want to read it, I would better have some more explanation than the cryptic language in which you instruct Mr. Dumbo. Hence, these are called comments which need to be written. We can tell the students that if I do not put slash slash here, our Dumbo will think it is an instruction and you will get completely confused, because Dumbo has a very limited vocabulary. It can understand only simple instructions. So far, we have seen only three instructions that Dumbo can understand. Dumbo can understand input, Dumbo can understand output, and Dumbo can understand computation. Notice that this is the first time we are introducing some complex computation here. Please note that many of our students will be familiar with X as the multiplication symbol and with a dash with two dots above and below as the division symbol. They may not all be familiar with slash and star. It is useful to explain that this is nothing but C multiplied by 9 divided by 5 plus 32. And they can relate very easily. Some of them of course may be familiar with the programming language, but even a person who is not familiar can understand that okay, I am using star to represent multiplication and I am using slash to represent division. And a student can easily relate that this formula will calculate the value of the temperature in Fahrenheit, and when I say F equal to this, I know the Dumbo's model, Dumbo is going to do these computations and put the resulting value in the location for F. Therefore, when I later on say C out, the value of F will come back to me. What the student may get confused about is what is this backslash n here. Now, this backslash n actually represents new line. In a proper C++ program, it is customary to write end L or end of line, which is a symbol defined and understood by C++. Here I am deliberately using backslash n, because even if you use a C program, in a printf instruction, you will usually have a backslash n at the end to go to the next line. I typically follow the description of this program by a quiz. In fact, there are two quiz questions. The first quiz that I ask is, approximately how many different programming languages have been defined so far by the computer scientists? So, you have to guess here. Now, of course, you are all teachers, so you know much more about computer programming than fresh students do. And it is not uncommon for me to find out that a majority of the students describe the number of programming languages as between 6 to 20. So, B is their choice. A few of them who are adventurous think of having more than 20 programming languages because they themselves have heard of 4 or 5. So, they think the world may be larger than what they think and they give an option C. Very rarely people give an option A, which is of course incorrect, but very rarely people give an option D, more than 100. I would submit that some of you may also not be completely aware of the large number of programming languages that have been defined from the time higher level programming languages are defined. In fact, in mid 80s itself, there were more than 600 programming languages that have been defined by various researchers. Most of the languages die the natural death. It was commented at one time that the ambition of every computer scientist researcher is to define a new programming language. And the only users were that scientist himself or herself and some of his or her students. However, the ability to define new programming language is very straightforward in the context of computer science research. Those of you who know, if I define a grammar for a programming language and if I define a semantics, then whatever mumbo jumbo I use, I essentially have a new programming language with me. So, the correct answer to this is more than 100. Why do I give this quiz? Not merely to emphasize that there are many more programming languages, but primarily to emphasize that therefore, it is stupid for any one of us to say that I know this programming language or I know that programming language. It doesn't make sense. If there are 600 programming languages, in my whole life I can never learn 600. But if I know programming concepts, then whichever language I am required to use for solving a particular problem, I will be able to learn that programming language and use it to solve my problem. That is the confidence which we wish to impart to our students. Incidentally, that is the confidence with which we teachers also must endeavor to work in our own professional lives. So, we ourselves should never say we are experts in C programming or C++ programming or something. We should just say we understand programming concepts. For example, I remember when the Unix environment first came and scripting languages such as awk were first introduced. Awk is, by the way, a very simple scripting language. But none of us were worried about using awk. In fact, in one of the joint entrance exam result tabulation, when something urgently was required by the committee of the chairman of JEE, I am talking about 20 years ago, we could very easily write some awk scripts on the fly, analyze the entire nationwide data and give them results in minutes. So, such is the power of programming and such is the plethora of programming languages that exist. We should never be worried about it and there is no harm in telling our students that there exists a large number of programming languages, but don't worry. What we are going to learn in this course is the basic programming concepts. Later on, we will tell our students that what we have studied here are procedural programming concepts. There are two important programming paradigms called object-oriented paradigm and functional programming paradigm. And eventually, those of you who learn computer science or learn these specific things can do some additional electives and learn those paradigms. But once you learn some basic programming paradigm, you should be able to learn any new programming language embodying those concepts on your own and carry on with it solving problems. The second quiz is more interesting. The second quiz says the symbol backslash n in double apostrophe in the instruction C out less f less backslash n will produce the following additional output. Here are four choices given. A, nothing visible and end of line is inserted. B, backslash n. C, n. D, I cannot guess. What is the objective of this quiz? Obviously, the correct answer is nothing visible and end of line is inserted. Who will be able to tell this answer correctly? Either somebody who has already known this programming language or somebody who has sat in the lab and put backslash n multiple times in a program while trying things, executed that program and found that nothing visible happens. However, every time he puts a backslash n, somehow the computer shows the next output on the next line. he or she will be able to guess this, provided one has executed many such programs. That is what we should emphasize to our students, that the lab environment is not merely to do the lab exercises which we have designed. We do design lab exercises such that the minimal things are well learned by the student, but a laboratory must be truly what its name suggests, namely it's a place for experimentation. So students should be encouraged to do variety of experiments, change this line, change that line. We should tell them that please remember that however smart Mr. Dumbo is, Dumbo cannot do one thing, Dumbo cannot shout back at us. So if we make mistakes in our program, the computer program will terminate possibly with an error, doesn't matter. We can rewrite that program 50 times. Given the speedy compilation and execution that we can do, it is possible to do variety of experimentation. So those who do those experimentation or those who are already familiar will give the answer A. Many of them will say B, many of them will say C. I have deliberately included a choice D here which says I cannot guess. The fact is for 90% of our students who have never seen computer or computer programming in their lives, they will not be able to guess. But they will hesitate in saying this. They come from a competitive environment. Remember the rat race for marks. They must know everything. And they think it is demeaning if they admit that they don't know anything. This is where we probably convey the most important message to our students. When I conduct this quiz, when I see not many D's here, I politely tell them, please understand that it is all right not to know things. I tell them that after 40 years of teaching experience, there are so many things which I still do not know. And only by admitting very clearly that I do not know this, I have been enthused to learn it either from the books or from colleagues or from other people. And I specifically tell them that many of the tricks in programming I have learned from my students and from my younger colleagues who are programmers who have done far more programming than I have. This is something that I think we should truly imbibe in ourselves and should convey to our students as well. Namely, in computer programming, just as in any other professional branch, learning is not limited to learning only from seniors or only from teachers. Learning happens everywhere. Indeed, the notion of a collaborative environment is that I will learn from all the members of the collaborating team. Let's take these 1,000 teachers. There will be some of you who are fresh teachers who have probably joined teaching last year. There will be some who are as old as me or even more ancient. But the fact of is that each one has something to offer and something to learn from others. And the same thing applies to these students. So I'll conclude this by saying that in this quiz, I would expect a large number of people to honestly admit that they cannot guess. And if they say so, we should be delighted. We say, you are very right, you cannot guess, because this is all numbo jumbo, this is all Greek and Latin. What is backslash n? In human context, please remember, interacting with humans in any kind of information exchange, no human being would have ever said backslash n to any other human being. So this is mumbo jumbo only meant for computers, which is perfectly fine. Here is an home assignment. This is distinct from the lab assignment. This is something I would like to share with you. We also have in our courses laboratories, but additionally we have home assignment. So when do students do home assignments? They do the labs in the afternoons, then they go and play their football or cricket or whatever, then they go have dinner, probably they see a movie or CAC session, and then around 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock in the night, they start working on home assignment. They work for 2 or 3 hours, of course sleep for 5, 6, 7 hours and come back in the class. I would submit that all of us who are all teachers should actually endeavor, if not in our regular life, which is preferable, but at least during the workshop, a habit of having some discussions after dinner with our colleagues. And it is during those discussions, I would suggest that we should attempt to do not only such home assignments, which I will rarely give, but something different, something that comes to your mind as to what we can do additionally which would enhance the effectiveness of teaching learning of computer programming to a large number of students whom we teach every day or every year or every semester. In this particular case, I am merely suggesting that you might want to consider rewriting these programs as proper C program. And the question that I want you to deliberate upon amongst the discussion is, how will you explain the difficult syntax and its semantics of the input output statements in C, namely the scanf and printf? It's not easy to explain. I have not found it easy at all. If you can find some solution or you can find a nice way of explaining it, then I will be very glad to do that. Failing which, however, I would submit that there is no harm in our continuing to use C in and C out for basic input output operation. Subsequently, at a later stage, we will introduce scanf and printf. And as I said, for all those teacher colleagues who would like to use scanf and printf right from day one, we will endeavor to convert all our program files into proper C program files, which will contain these statements. That is roughly the end of my talk now. Thank you very much. Over and out from Professor Phatak from IIT Bombay.